Hello, my name is Bob Ostertag. I am a writer and a composer, and I also teach at the University of California, where I've been for several years. After the recent visit of Milo Ianopoulos, where his event was shut down on our campus, the chancellor of our university asked me to give a campus lecture on Milo Ianopoulos and free speech on campus and what we might learn from these events. And as a longtime queer activist and activist for human rights and social justice, I was happy to do so because I think these events show weaknesses in our community, in our academic community of scholarship, in our queer community, in our progressive community, and in our California community that need to be addressed because they're being exploited by people with very dark interests. And so it's important that we examine this. Now, Milo has fallen spectacularly, as I'm sure you know. I think he's done. I think we are done with him. I think we will. I would be very surprised if Milo manages to resurrect his career in any substantial way. You simply cannot be a spokesperson for the far right in the United States and have videos about pedophilia following you around. So Milo is done. And I have read numerous articles since his spectacular fall, arguing that basically he was an idiot and had nothing of substance to say and was basically just a schoolyard bully. And isn't it wonderful that we never have to think about him again or think about what happened again? And actually, I disagree. I think, as I said, there are many reasons that we need to think carefully about what happened. The first is that we have counter-narratives in our country now about freedom of speech. At the national level, we have one narrative, which is all about freedom of speech, in particular, freedom of the press, which is a kind of freedom of speech, being under threat in ways that many of us never thought we would see in this country in our lifetime. Freedom of press and freedom of speech is under threat, as you know, from the Trump administration, Steve Bannon, Jeff Sessions, and the far right. But at the same time we have that narrative at the national level, there's a counter-narrative which has emerged on college campuses around the country. And the counter-narrative is that free speech is under threat from the left. And we at UC Davis are right at the center of that counter-narrative. So yes, we do need to think very carefully about these matters and put our house in order, because we are in for a real struggle in the next few years, and we need to evaluate our internal weaknesses if we are going to meet this challenge. So the second reason to pay attention to what happened with Milo Ianopoulos is that whenever any really new phenomena appears in history, I think it's important to take notice. And Milo Ianopoulos marks the entrance of a new character on the American political stage, the flamboyantly gay and far-right persona. We've never had this in the United States. We've certainly had gay men who were very powerful and very right-wing, J. Edgar Hoover, the head of the FBI during the Cold War, and Roy Cohn, the principal architect of McCarthyism, both come immediately to mind. But these were closeted individuals, and Milo is flamboyantly gay. He appeared at the actual center of power in this country until his spectacular fall. His boss, he was an editor for Breitbart News, which meant his boss was Steve Bannon. That's the same Steve Bannon who now has an office in the White House right next to Trump's office. Trump never wants him out of eyesight, essentially. So Milo appeared with 2 degrees of separation from the president. Milo has 500,000 subscribers to his YouTube channel, and most of those are so-called millennials, precisely the one part of the electorate that Trump and the Republicans have had such a difficult time winning. So Milo is their liaison to the millennials. So yes, a very, very important figure, and a very strange person to find on the national stage in 2017. He is a gay, not only an out gay man, but an out gay man who talks frequently and openly about his desire to be straight. He's often said that if he could find conversion therapy that works, he would do it, so that because he would rather be heterosexual. He's spoken about how if he ever had a child, he would want the child to be straight, and he would do everything within his power to make his child straight. So these are the kinds of ideas that one would expect to find in the 1950s or 1940s, but not in 2017. So how strange that the face of the Trump counter-revolution on college campuses would be this flamboyantly gay man who uses the rhetorical toolkit of what used to be called the gay left. So he sashays up to the microphone and says, "Hello, faggots," to audiences of very right-wing listeners. His tour bus, as you can see here, is painted with giant letters that say "Dangerous Faggot," and he calls his 23 campus tour the "Dangerous Faggot Tour." Well, this is quite shocking to me, because I was a dangerous faggot. At least I wanted to be a dangerous faggot. I wasn't nearly as dangerous as Milo is, but this was back in the gay liberation days. We all wanted to be dangerous faggots. We called ourselves faggots. The most radical militant zine of the gay liberation years was the fag rag. We wrote books with titles like "The Faggots and Their Friends Between Revolutions." To be a fag was to be part of the least compromising, least assimilationist, most in your face, most gender transgressive part of the queer world at that time. Vaginal Davis, African American gender fluid performer, and a dear friend of mine had a band called Black Fag, which was a playful riff on the name Black Flag, which was a very aggro sort of white punk rock band. Now, as a University of California professor, I'm not even supposed to say the word fag on campus. And I did a test run of this speech for some students just to see what their reaction was. And the main reaction I got was they wanted to make sure I understood that I was going to get a lot of blowback for using the word faggot, even in this context. And there's lots of other words I'm not supposed to say on my campus today, particularly around the queer students. And the fact is that speech today on college campuses is highly regulated, and it is most regulated in what's become known as the LGBT community. And so, of course, that is what opens the door for a right-wing guy like Milo Yiannopoulos to appropriate the language of what used to be the left and show up as the dangerous faggot. And I do believe that Milo is the LGBT monster. We need to acknowledge this. He comes out of and takes advantage of LGBT culture as it is currently constituted. This is not a case of we are everywhere and therefore we're also in the alt-right, and so it's just happenstance that Milo just happens to be queer. No, no. This is a queer phenomena, and we need to think very carefully about it. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about the story of Milo, how he came to prominence, because the facts are actually not very well known, and the details are important because they have to do with how power is shifting in the United States, and if we want to respond to the moment with any kind of efficacy, we have to understand these changes. To understand Milo's story, we really have to begin with a website called 4chan. And 4chan was a early social media site. It was what was called an image board. It was for gamers and nerds and young men who were aficionados of Japanese anime. That's a particular kind of Japanese animation, very, very popular with gamers, computer gamers. It was a site that tended towards very dark, self-deprecating humor. It had a very Lord of the Flies vibe. It became hugely influential in popular culture. All kinds of internet memes emerged from 4chan, the laughing out loud cats, and even the whole notion of a still image with some kind of shocking or arresting picture with letters above and below in white block letters with black outlines. Even that whole notion of what a meme should look like emerged from 4chan. And one of the things that made 4chan so popular, as you can see from this slide, is that the users are anonymous. You don't have to create an account and you don't have to identify yourself. As you can see from the discussion there, everybody who posts in a discussion is identified as anonymous. And this ability to stay anonymous on the site was one of the things that created the dynamic that became so associated with 4chan. So who are these 4chaners? Well, let's look at this slide here, which shows the number of men in this country who are not at work. And I don't mean unemployed. I mean outside of the labor force. These are men not looking for work. They don't show up in unemployment numbers, and their numbers have exploded in recent years. You can see here from this slide that just a few years ago, there were 2 million of these men in the United States, and now we are approaching 8 million. So they have quadrupled. Two-thirds of them are taking prescription painkillers. 7 out of 10 of those of them who are in their 20s are living with a parent or close relative, and they spend enormous amounts of time playing computer games and watching internet porn. This is a serious demographic phenomena in our country that has everything to do with globalization and automation and everything to do with the rise of Donald Trump. The 4chaners, and there are millions of them, started doing what they called raids, where they would flood into internet sites to do sort of silly, harmless things. There was a scientific boat that, in order to publicize the launch of this boat, they had an online voting to vote for a new name for the boat, and the 4chaners flooded the site and named the boat Boaty McBoatface, which probably wasn't what the owners of the boat had in mind, but it didn't really hurt anybody. So lots of things like that. The 4chaners started appearing In the real world, IRL, and for Chinese, in the real world, their first IRL demonstration was, bizarrely enough, against the Church of Scientology for reasons that we don't even need to go into, but somehow in the random ricocheting of attention in the 4chan world, they got caught up in denouncing Scientology. They all showed up. Several hundred people showed up in Manhattan at the headquarters of the Church of Scientology. They made videos pretending that there was a shadowy and powerful cabal called Anonymous that was going after the Church of Scientology. This comes from the anonymous postings in 4chan that we looked at before. 4chaners started calling themselves, "Hey Anonymous, hi Anonymous, hey I'm Anonymous over here." And by the time these demonstrations came about, they had riffed that into this meme that there actually was a group called Anonymous, and they started showing up in their Guy Fawkes masks at Occupy actions around the country. Another one of the memes that emerged was Pepe the Frog. Pepe the Frog is sort of become the national cultural symbol of self-deprecation and loserdom. And a lot of the vernacular of 4chan has to do with a kind of extreme self-deprecation. In 4chanese, when you say somebody should become a hero, it means that they should kill themselves. If somebody claims the moniker Forever Alone, it means they acknowledge that they are never, in all likelihood, they will never have a wife or a romantic partner or a girlfriend, and they will be forever alone in their parents' basement, jerking off to internet porn and playing computer games. So it's when this phenomena called Gamergate emerged in 2014 that the sort of dark humor of 4chan morphed into something that was actually menacing, socially and culturally menacing, and that self-deprecation began to get pointed outwards at the rest of the culture. Now, Gamergate is so Byzantine that it's difficult for somebody outside of the gaming world or the 4chan world to really grasp. But the short version is that there was a guy whose girlfriend dumped him, and she was a game developer, and he posted a long, rambling rant about her online. And somehow, in the random world of 4chan, this guy's rant about his ex-girlfriend got picked up as a rallying cry in the 4chan world. And remember, the 4chaners are big computer gamers, and this woman was a game developer. And somehow this morphed from a situation of a bunch of lonely, forever alone young men taking a lurid interest in a particular woman's sex life into sort of a crusade against feminism in computer games. And somehow the 4chaners became convinced that there were these feminists out there who were trying to take over the world of computer games and deprive them of their male-dominated, forever alone world, virtual world. And right away, this free speech meme emerged. You can see from these images here, it became sort of a meme of the Gamergate that the feminists of the world were trying to deny their right to free speech. And this became very ugly very fast. By the end of it, not just the first woman, but two other women who came to her defense, who were also somehow involved in one way or another with computer games, were all getting death threats and rape threats and threats of horrible violence and their personal contact information and where they worked and so forth published on the internet. Eventually, three women fled their homes because of this deluge of digital threats and hatred being dumped on them, and there were bomb threats on both sides. There were Gamergate events that had to be evacuated because of bomb threats, and also counter Gamergate events that had to be canceled because of bomb threats. So it really became an ugly, ugly mess. And this is where Milo Yiannopoulos really appears on the public radar as the public face of Gamergate. So Milo was a college dropout who had started a tech website that failed, and it failed miserably. A lot of his employees filed various kinds of complaints against him for not paying them for their work. He threatened to blackmail them. So this kind of weird, ugly personal vibe has been following him around from the very beginning. After he lost his website, he became a sort of C-list media pundit in the British media. But he sort of hit a groove with Gamergate. He wasn't even a gamer. He professed no interest in video games per se, but he was willing to be the public face of this 4chan troll army, who were all anonymous. Remember, on 4chan, everything was anonymous, and it was one of the first unwritten rules of 4chan was to never identify yourself by name if you were a 4chaner. So Milo comes along, and he's willing to step forward. And he describes the 4channers as youthful, fun, irreverent, and delightfully humorous young men, and that nobody understands or gets how fun and delightful they are, and nobody gets it that all these threats and things are actually just humor. And he coins the term sexodus. And I'll read this quote here because I think it's indicative. He wrote, "The rise of feminism has fatally coincided with the rise of video games, internet porn, and sometime in the near future, sex robots. With all these options available and the growing perils of real-world relationships, men are simply walking away from women, basically." And a writer named Dale Barron, who has written about this and who was an early 4chaner, made a very perceptive comment about this, I believe. He said, "Yiannopoulos has inverted what has actually happened to make his audience feel good. Men who have retreated to video games and internet porn can now characterize their helpless flight as an empowered conscious choice to reject women for something else." So this is how this gay man, oddly enough, becomes the public face and spokesperson for these deeply asocial straight guys jerking off to internet porn in their parents' basement. They intersect on misogyny. And in fact, there's always, you know, the gay male world has always had many threads and many corners. And one of those corners has always been, there's always been a part of the gay male world that has been deeply misogynist. And Milo Yiannopoulos is very, very much from that part of the gay world. So he gets picked up by Breitbart News and Steve Bannon, and they make him the tech editor of Breitbart. And when they say tech editor, that doesn't mean he's going to be reviewing any iPhones or computer games. When they say tech editor, what they mean is that they see him as bringing the 4chan constituency into the Breitbart operation. And that's why Breitbart News and Steve Bannon are willing to put up with this flamboyantly gay guy, because he's bringing a constituency that they need, and he's bringing it in large numbers. All right, so the next thing that happens is Milo writes the scathing review of Ghostbusters, the remake of the Ghostbusters movie starring four female leads in place of the original four male leads. So he writes this scathing review, and he says, "The beloved franchise from our childhood, with a stake driven through its heart, head chopped off, body burned, and buried at a crossroads, a movie to help lonely middle-aged women feel better about themselves after being left on the shelf." So he does the same rhetorical trick of trying to cast the forever aloneness of his 4chan base as a conscious choice. And it's actually the women who are lonely, and therefore they're making these terrible movies to make themselves feel better. Well, Milo's review brings the full weight of the 4chan troll army down on the head of Leslie Jones, African-American actress who was one of the stars of the Ghostbuster movie. She got deluged with all kinds of horrendous threats and racist comments and racist images. She had no idea what was about to hit her. She didn't know anything about 4chan and all of this stuff. So she was just utterly horrified. Eventually she quits Twitter. Milo gets banned from Twitter. And then what's Milo gonna do? He's banned from Twitter, which is really his medium. He's trying to function as a media pundit on talk shows and TV news shows. He doesn't do very well. He comes across in the real world as unhinged, as purely vindictive, as really nothing but a brat. And then he tries to position himself as a spokesman for the alt-right. Now the alt-right, you know, the term alt-right isn't even that old. So the term had just been coined by Richard Spencer, and Milo pretty much tried to do exactly what he did with 4chan with the alt-right. So he wrote a piece in Breitbart News that was pitched as an introduction to the alt-right, what you need to know about the alt-right. And he wrote, "The alt-right is a movement born out of the youthful, subversive, underground edges of the internet." This is, of course, just how he described 4chan earlier. He says, "Are they actually bigots? No more than the death metal devotees in the 1980s were actually Satanists." So he tries to pull the same trick he pulled with 4chan to position himself at the head of the alt-right, but it doesn't go so well. The Daily Stormer, which is the explicitly fascist website for self-consciously identified fascists in the United States, writes an article called "Breitbart's Alt-Right Analysis is the Product of a Degenerate Homosexual and an Ethnic Mongrel." And ethnic mongrel, because Yiannopoulos' grandmother is Jewish. And they write, "Of course we hate these people," meaning Jews, "saying that we don't hate them and it's all a big joke because we want to anger our parents is not just spin, it's an outright lie. This isn't some big joke. We actually literally hate these people." So Milo's moment at the head of the alt-right lasts all of a few seconds. And but what he and Bannon figure out is that he does much better on college campuses. When he appears on college campuses, which he does quite frequently, he hones down his rhetoric. A lot of the racism is gone. A lot of the anti-immigration stuff is gone. Even some of the misogyny is gone. A lot of the anti-Muslim stuff is gone. And really what he almost limits himself to doing nothing but ridiculing safe space, trigger warning culture. And more than anything, talking about freedom of speech and the lack of freedom of speech on college campuses. And this resonates with many, many students. Many students who did not vote for Trump, many students who do not think of themselves as right-wing, but who do think that there is a lack of freedom of speech on college campuses, and who detest safe space trigger warning culture. So Milo begins to build a fan base outside of the world of 4chan. And again, this is a fan base of millennials and college students, exactly the piece of the puzzle that has eluded Trump and the Republicans and even Steve Bannon. So when Milo goes to a college campus and Sasha is up to the mic and says, "Hello, faggots," the way to understand that is to realize that he doesn't think there's any faggots in the audience, or if he does, he understands that not many gay people actually go to his events. So he's not actually saying hello to gay men in the audience. What he's doing is he is provoking the people he sees as the campus word police. And he's doing it in a way that he finds funny. And he has his finger on the pulse to understand that when he does that, many people in his audience will hear him as making fun of how uptight academia has become about policing words, and in particular, how uptight the academic left has become in terms of just lacking a sense of humor. And so this is why this bizarre thing of this, you know, queenie gay guy appearing on college campuses for the far right and Donald Trump and saying, "Hello, faggots," this is how this makes sense in this weird new world in which we live in. In some ways, Milo is a right-wing yippie. I don't know if you remember the yippies from the 1960s, but the yippies were sort of the bad boy provocateurs of the hippie movement. And in particular, Milo reminds me of Abby Hoffman, the best-known yippie who famously provoked all kinds of anger and hurt. And this quote of Abby Hoffman here, where he says, "My critique of democracy begins and ends with this point. Kids must be educated to disrespect authority, or else democracy is a farce." Those words could almost come from the mouth of Milo Yiannopoulos. Now, my point here is not to make any sort of moral equivalency between Milo Yiannopoulos and Abby Hoffman. Abby Hoffman is actually something of a hero of mine. I thought he was fantastic in the 60s, and then over the decades since, his trajectory has been something that I've had a lot of respect for. And I have nothing of the sort from Milo Yiannopoulos. And of course, Abby Hoffman never voiced any of the hateful, bigoted kinds of stuff that comes out of the mouth of Milo Yiannopoulos. But nevertheless, there is a certain similarity between the two of them in their posture towards authority and in favor of free speech. Here's a quote that from Milo at the University of Michigan, and I'm going to read it in its entirety. He says, "We are in a situation now where students go into a university and come out dumber than when they went in. They are infantilized by safe space and trigger warning culture, or the idea that interrogating a new idea, coming into contact with a school of thought or person that doesn't conform to your prejudices, is somehow problematic, that it gives rise to trauma. This evening, there is a safe space at Michigan University to protect the safety and emotional well-being of students from this dangerous faggot." That is insane. That line gets big applause. It got big applause at University of Michigan. It would get big applause at University of California at Davis. And many of the students who would be applauding would be from the center and the left. Now, I'm giving you the best of Milo Yiannopoulos here. I could fill this entire lecture with nothing but the most horrendous, offensive, racist, bigoted, Islamophobic, misogynist, even homophobic, transphobic, you name it. There is so much utterly reprehensible stuff that comes out of this guy's mouth. And I'm not going to dwell on that because I assume that if you've found your way to this video, you already know about all that. And it truly is hateful stuff, and I don't want to repeat it. But I just want to make the point that I'm not trying to paint an overly I'm not trying to paint Milo as something that he's not. What I am trying to say is that there's a reason that he had a following on college campuses. Richard Spencer shows up at a college at UC Davis, nobody would go. The KKK showed up, nobody would go. Milo has fans, and it's important to realize why. Okay, so just before his fall, Milo appeared first of all at UC Davis, then at University of Washington at Seattle, and then at University of California at Berkeley. I was present at all three of those events, and they sort of form an escalating narrative of confrontation between him and protesters, and between protesters and the campus administrations. I went to all three, and I'd like to describe what they were like, because I think it's an important part of the story. At none of the campuses was he, at UC Davis he was not able to speak. Protesters came and blocked the building, and eventually the campus police were not going to mount the scale of operation that would have been required to clear the entrance and allow the event to happen. So the event didn't happen, but there was a long line of people waiting to see Milo, and I spent hours in the line there, and also at UW Seattle, talking to people. So I was so curious, who is it? I mean, these are some of the most liberal college campuses in the United States, or for that matter, in the world. University of Washington at Seattle and University of California at Davis. And at both places, the line of students waiting to see Milo was much larger than the group, the number of students who showed up to protest. At Davis, the line of people waiting to see him was just a little bit bigger. In Seattle, it was quite a lot bigger. So I was very curious who these people were. So who were they? First of all, the students are mostly from the sciences. They're not from the humanities. If you mention this to them, if in the process of talking to them, I would say, oh, you're from the sciences. You know, it seems like everybody in this line is from the sciences. They would laugh and they would say, of course, we're all from the sciences. Everybody from the humanities is brainwashed. They were multicultural. In fact, I would say the people in line, the crowd waiting to see Milo was less predominantly white than the crowd of protesters shutting down the event. So this was not a case of all white people going to see a white speaker. There was a good mix of men and women. And in both places, what I noticed was that there was maybe 10 or 20% of the people in line were actually Trump supporters or alt-right people. They had their red baseball caps that said, Make America Great Again. But then there was another 30%, I would say, who were Milo fans. And these are people who watch all his YouTube videos, and they follow him, and they think of themselves as Milo fans. And for these folks, they see him primarily as a comedian. They contextualize him as a late-night television, late-night cable TV comic. They think he's funny, and as they will point out, that all late-night cable TV comedians are offensive. Amy Schumer's offensive. They're offensive. Being offensive is the stock currency of late night television comedy. And they didn't think Milo should be singled out for his offensiveness just because he was from the right. And the Milo fans ran the political spectrum. Some were right wing, some were quite left wing, some were center, some were libertarian, some were described themselves as off the spectrum, but it was a very eclectic mix. The protesters would chant no Milo, no KKK, no fascist USA, and the people waiting in line would chant back, go back to your safe space. I have two quotes here that I thought I would share. Then these are both from students in line, and I thought they were particularly thoughtful. One said, I like that Milo is really confident and unabashed in his opinions, and that he's really open about what he believes. I wish everyone would kind of take note of that and be more willing to speak out about what they believe. So even though I don't agree with what he is saying all the time, I still support his right to say it, and I want to support him. This is a very common sentiment I heard, that students are fed up with the fact that nobody on campuses actually speaks freely, that everybody's thinking 10 steps ahead about who's going to get offended, and they feel that their education is stunted and not as deep as they had hoped it would be because of the lack of debate. So for them, Milo barging in and mouthing off is a breath of fresh air. And the second quote is this one here, who's the student says, I am not a Milo supporter. I find him very interesting. I would very much like to have a conversation with him. I would be friends with Milo. People exaggerate what Milo says and make it even more hyperbolic than it already was. Milo has a lot of character. He says blatantly absurd things so that you listen to him. This is also a very common sentiment that I found in line. Okay, let's go on to the event at the University of Washington, Seattle. This event happened the night of the day that Trump was inaugurated president. So this was a very, very loaded day. I was freaked out. I think many, many people in our country were freaked out, and certainly the students at the University of Washington in Seattle were freaked out. The event was at night. You can see here from the picture that there's the campus police dressed up in their RoboCop finery in front of the building where the event is supposed to be. Is supposed to take place. In front of the police is the so-called black bloc protesters, dressed head to toe in black and with their faces covered, and clearly readying themselves for a fight. Oftentimes violence follows around the black bloc, and the night that Trump was inaugurated president was clearly going to be an escalation. You can see that there are two lines waiting to get into the event. One line is for non-students and one for students. In the picture on the right, you can see the non-student lines, and you see all the red Trump hats and Trump t-shirts. So the real Trump supporters were heavily skewed towards non-students. And then in the picture on the left, you can see another line which goes all the way through the plaza and actually wraps around out of the picture and continues for quite a long ways outside of the picture frame where you can't see it. And that is the students who are waiting to see Milo. Around the edges, you can see the peaceful protester students who, here's some close-up pictures of them. They have signs that say things like, Milo, let's talk, and love fiercely. And they're sort of around the edges, looking very forlorn and lost and wondering what their role is, when there's so clearly this confrontation building between the police, the Black Bloc, and the Trump supporters. And here's the pictures of the Black Bloc. They brought a great big sign that says, "No more presidents." That was their slogan for the day, along with another sign that said, "Become ungovernable." All right, so what happened? So at one point, the police mounted an operation on a scale that was sufficient to move the Black Bloc aside just long enough to get maybe 75, 100 people into the building. The Black Bloc moved back, covered the hole, or filled the hole. The police announced that the event was now sealed and that no more people would be allowed in the building. The Black Bloc started to throw bricks and paint bombs, some of which were thrown at the police, some were thrown at the students in line. Several projectiles got thrown in my general direction. Here you can see on the left, there's a student who's been hit in the face with a blue paint bomb. Fighting and shoving is breaking out all over the place. It's really, really tense. Ugly scene. And then finally, one of the Trump supporters pulls out a gun and shoots one of the protesters dressed head to toe in black. You can see in the picture on the upper right, the tall white man is the man who's just been shot. And then in the picture at the bottom, you see him getting medical attention from the campus police and his blood all over the sidewalk. I've been amazed how little press coverage this event received. I mean, think about it. The night that Trump was inaugurated president of the United States, one of his supporters pulled a gun and shot a protester on an American campus. And it's really disappeared. It would never really made a big deal in the media. I've often wondered why that was. I think it's at least in part because the shooting victim is an anarchist who doesn't believe in working with the police, so declined to press charges. But it was an extraordinary night, and the wound was a serious wound. He was in critical condition in an ICU for days. Fortunately, he recovered. Inside, the scene inside was equally bizarre as the scene outside. By the time Milo took the stage, he appeared to be quite drunk, like really slurring his words and kind of staggering around. And he decided he would break the ice by pulling out a pair of jumper cables and telling this weird shtick about how now that Mike Pence was vice president of the United States, faggots like him could try out electroshock conversion therapy to see if it really worked without whining liberals bothering them, and invited any other faggots who were present in the audience to come out to his tour bus after his talk to get their nipples hooked up to the bus battery. It was completely bizarre. And then when he finished, the campus police made everybody in the audience remove their Trump hats, hide their Trump paraphernalia, and escorted them out, evacuating them through an underground parking garage. Now, there's a lot been said about the media silos that we live in this country now, and I suspect that most people who watch this YouTube video will be people who read the left and liberal media. And so you probably didn't know that on inauguration night, people at an event on college campus were made to hide their Trump paraphernalia by campus police and were evacuated out of an underground parking garage. But if you read the right-wing media, you would know this. And you would know that people who voted for your candidate are not safe on a college campus. At least they weren't that night. Okay, next he came to Berkeley And anybody who was following this could see that Berkeley was going to be the mother of all Milo wars. The confrontations between Milo, the police, and the protesters had been building at every campus, and Berkeley was going to be the crown jewel of the whole thing. The San Francisco Bay Area is sort of the spiritual and geographical center of black blocism in the United States, and you all probably know what happened. I just want to show a quick video here.
When the conflict did arrive, it did so in the form of polytechnics and smoke and strife and anger, not only about the speaker and about what he might say, but also about his right to say it, even here in the birthplace of the free speech movement.
Well, I was carrying my sign. It said, the First Amendment is for everyone, protects all speech, even Milo.
So that's extraordinary. I mean, here's a man who got beat up on the UC Berkeley campus for carrying a sign that said free speech is for everyone. And, Berkeley is the site of the free speech movement of the 1960s. That is deeply, deeply troubling to me. And here's one more video from that night.
Are you surprised, ma'am?
So that is a Trump supporter in line getting pepper sprayed in the face at very close range on camera while she is being interviewed by ABC News. Now, I'm sure you all know that UC Davis, the campus where I am a professor, became very world famous a few years ago for the incident where a campus policeman pepper sprayed a row of seated students at close range during the Occupy movement. This became a meme that was repeated all over the world. In fact, I think probably even today, UC Davis is better known for this pepper spray incident than just about anything else. Well, again, if you live in the left, liberal, and even centrist media silo, you probably think that is still the University of California pepper spray meme. But if you read Breitbart News and watch Fox News and read the right-wing news, then you think that the new pepper spray meme is this Trump supporter getting pepper sprayed in the face on camera. So when you put these two images together, I can't imagine a more graphic and troubling visual representation of the counter-narratives that I talked about at the beginning of how freedom of speech, the counter-narratives in which there's a one narrative at the level of national politics in which freedom of speech is being threatened by the Trump administration, and a counter-narrative at the level of college campuses in which student protesters are the bad guys when it comes to freedom of speech. All right, not long after Berkeley comes Milo's downfall. Well, actually, immediately after Berkeley, Berkeley was the best thing that ever happened to Milo Yiannopoulos. He got a Trump tweet at 3 a.m, which is surely the holy grail for somebody like Milo Yiannopoulos. Trump tweeted out late that night that maybe he would cut off funding to the University of California, Berkeley, for not being able to guarantee the safety of the event. Milo was invited to the White House, jumped on a plane to fly across the country to be received at the White House as the hero of free speech on campus, decided to reroute to New York City because he had so many television invitations, got invited to speak at the CPAC conference. Really seemed like he was blasting into the stratosphere. And then came the pedophilia video where he seemed to be advocating for sex between grown men and 13-year-old boys. I assume if you've made your way to this video, you know about that and about Milo's fall from grace, and we don't need to spend any more time on it now. But the one point I would like to make is that Milo's flirtation with pedophilia was not a big secret. Anybody who went through Milo's videos would have known this. This was not the only video in which he made comments like this. And even at the Republican National Convention last summer, he organized a Gays for Trump party, which was also organized to be an art opening for a Twinks for Trump art show, photography exhibit, which Milo organized. And these are pictures from the Twinks for Trump art exhibit. And it's quite shocking to think that these photos were displayed at the Republican National Convention. So yes, Milo's flirtation and borderline ice skating around the whole notion of pedophilia has been part of the Milo shtick since the very beginning. And Milo may have crashed and burned, but just last week, the photographer who took the photos for the Twinks for Trump exhibition got White House press credentials. So the New York Times isn't invited to the White House all the time now, but the Twinks for Trump photographer is. What a strange time we live in. Okay, so that's the story of the rise and fall of Milo Yiannopoulos. So what are we to make of all this? What can we learn from this? I'd like to make a few points. The first one is that Milo's downfall did not come from silencing him, but from listening to him, from letting him speak and listening. Allegedly, he was done in by a single 16-year-old Canadian girl who went back through his videos and found the pedophilia thing and then forwarded that to a group of four people who call themselves the Reagan Battalion, who tweeted it out to the CPAC organizers, and that was the end of Milo. I don't know for certain that it was actually a 16-year-old girl and these four people, but that's the story that's been making it around the blogs. If that's true, then it's quite amazing that those five people managed to accomplish what thousands of student protesters could not. So why were they so much more powerful than the protesters? Well, the protesters were so focused on denying Milo the right to speak that they didn't really notice what he was saying. So once again, it's important to note that Milo's downfall did not come from no platforming him or silencing him, but from letting him speak. Second, the problem of free speech on college campuses is a serious and profound problem. This is certainly something that we have to take away from this. And yes, the Black Bloc and that kind of protest is a serious problem, and it's vexing, and I'm not sure what to do about it. But what about students? What about other students? And what about faculty? I am routinely stunned with conversations that I have with students and faculty about freedom of speech and the level of understanding of the importance of the concept and the history of it and how it's been so crucial to maintaining the rights we have in this country and in other parts of the world is at such a low level at college campuses now that it leaves me profoundly troubled. So, before Milo came to Berkeley, there was a letter that was signed by over 100 Berkeley faculty sent to the school administration demanding that the administration not allow the Yiannopoulos event to take place. And I'm going to quote this letter here because I think this is important. So this is the University of California. This is over 100 faculty at the campus that saw the free speech movement of the 1960s, one of the iconic moments of the 1960s. So what did they write? They said, Yiannopoulos' views passed from protected free speech to incitement, harassment, and defamation once they publicly target individuals in his audience or on campus. such actions are protected neither by free speech nor by academic freedom. And they referred in particular to an event that happened in Milwaukee where Milo had put a picture of a transgender student, had projected this photo of this transgender student on the screen while he spoke and mocked this student in very crude and offensive ways. So they say, and the faculty's point was that this incident was the grounds on which the university could claim prior restraint and not allow the Innopolis event to happen. So they write in their letter, Innopolis spoke in his public lecture about a transgender student in derogatory ways, going so far as to project a picture of this student during his lecture. He projected an older photo of her. Students are not public figures, and they do not agree to have their likeness projected in public or to be demeaned simply by virtue of attending an event. So this version of what had happened in Milwaukee was repeated on lots of blogs and in some more establishment media. I think that must be where the Berkeley faculty got their version of events from, because their version of events matches this event that went around the blogosphere, but it's incorrect. And this is the point where this little YouTube video is going to differ from my UC Davis lecture, because at UC Davis, what I did was I showed the video, the image that Milo projected on the screen. And my point was to show that it was not a private image. In fact, this student had been protesting the university's transgender policies and had been in the student newspaper, on the television news, and in numerous blogs, being interviewed and speaking at her own of her own volition and her own intent about these issues. And when I put this image up on the screen at the talk at Davis, several students and some community people just erupted in protest that I had no right to show that image, because that student, they said, is now taking estrogen and has transitioned to a more feminine appearing look and no longer wants those images shown, and it would be hateful of me to show those images. Now, I have no ill will towards this student at all. In fact, my heart goes out to this student, because she was really demeaned and mocked by Milo in extremely offensive terms. And I am sure that the experience was painful for her and continues to be so. And I certainly don't want to make a already painful situation even worse. On the other hand, this letter was wrong. It's factually wrong. Milo did not troll through the internet and find somebody's private picture and then somehow figure out that that student was going to be in the audience. I mean, how could he have even known that? And then put up that picture to mock this person who was in the audience. Milo showed up at the campus, picked up the campus newspaper, and there on the front page was this story. And it was on TV. And so he used it. It's troubling to me that over 100 Berkeley faculty were willing to take a really anti-free speech position and demand that the university shut down an event because of the political content of the speech without even doing the most basic fact-checking, just a quick YouTube or Google search of Milo transgender student in Milwaukee would immediately reveal these pictures. So I'm going to show the pictures here with the student's face blacked out. And actually, after my talk at Davis, I had an extended conversation with some of the students who complained, and they actually suggested that if I had blacked out the student's face, everything would be fine. So I am going to present this blacked out here, but I also want to use this as an opportunity to ask the question, what would our world look like if we all had the right to delete images of ourselves from the historical record? What if Milo had the right to do that? What if Trump had the right to do that? It's a dystopian world. It's a world in which history, as we think of it, doesn't exist. It's the kind of world where... So, I don't mean to demean this student any further, but yes, I do mean to say that I don't want to see images like this on the television news where there's big black spots that have been censored out of the picture. That's not a world that I'm comfortable with. The demand by the Davis and Berkeley faculty was that the campus administration should be able to censor guest speakers invited by student groups based on the political content of their speech. Now, had the administration acquiesced to this demand, the consequences would have been catastrophic because the university would have been surely sued by Milo Yiannopoulos and Breitbart News, and Breitbart would have won. There is no legal basis for censoring speech, particularly that's prior restraint. I mean, the legal bar for that is very, very high, as it should be. And imagine at this time in history, with Steve Bannon telling the media to shut up, and the New York Times being disinvited from the White House press corps and White House events, and Trump at his rallies saying the protesters should be carried out on stretchers. At this moment, imagine if the University of California and Breitbart News had gotten in a lawsuit over free speech rights, and the University of California would have lost. And the judicial system would have ruled that academia was trying to silence free speech. In this country, the political consequences of that would have been catastrophic. And thank goodness the school administration did not acquiesce to that demand. It's worth noting that this whole demand is exactly counter to the demands of the free speech movement at UC Berkeley in the 60s. In fact, the last time the Berkeley faculty took a position on free speech on campus was in 1964, when the Faculty Senate voted on a resolution that said, quote, "The content of speech or advocacy should not be restricted by the university," close quote. Note that there is no exemption for incitement, for harassment, for mocking, for insults, for hate speech. No, there's only one kind of speech, protected speech, in this resolution from 1964. And when that was passed, that was seen as the absolute total victory for the student activists at the day. And it's so ironic that the plaza in which the riot at Berkeley happened against the Indianapolis event was directly across the way from the Free Speech Movement Cafe at the Berkeley campus, which memorializes the free speech movement, and the walls are all decorated with life-size posters of free speech activists. Finally, on this point, I will quote a statement from the board of directors of the Free Speech Movement Archives, who are all veterans of the free speech movement. We're all free speech activists at Berkeley in the 1960s, and they wrote, "Berkeley's free speech tradition won through struggle, suspension, arrest, fines, jail time by free speech movement activists is far more important than Indianapolis, and it is that tradition's endurance that concerns us. We were thus disappointed that so many Berkeley faculty signed an open letter supporting such a ban." Okay, the next thing I want to do is take on this notion of hate speech. Now, we've gotten to the point where we talk about hate speech so much that many of us seem to think it's actually a legal category. There is no legal category of hate speech in this country. And while many of my colleagues would argue that there should be, I would urge that we think very carefully about that, because if you think about it, the claim that there should be a category of speech called hate speech and that that should not be protected speech, to make that claim is to claim that the First Amendment goes too far, that it gives us too many rights, that the First Amendment allows too much speech, and we need to curtail the First Amendment. I think, particularly right now, that is a terrible idea. What we need to be doing now is defending our constitutional rights, which are under real threat. The absolute last thing we should be doing right now is volunteering that we would like to have fewer constitutional rights than we've had for the last 200 years. What a terrible idea. The faculty letter also talked about incitement, speech that is incitement, and they said that speech that is incitement shouldn't be protected the same way that other kinds of speech is protected. Well, first of all, the idea that, well, speech that incites, that's all political speech. I mean, who engages in political speech if they don't want something to happen as a result of it? If you don't want something to happen, then you're just a blowhard. Of course you want something to happen. That's what incitement is. During World War I in this country, thousands of anti-war activists were jailed for precisely this reason, because they tried to incite people to avoid the draft and to not go in the army. They were jailed. Hundreds of them died at Alcatraz Island, which was a military prison at the time. Eugene Debs, the chair of the Socialist Party of this country, was incarcerated on that claim. Now, between World War I and the Vietnam War, 50 years of jurisprudence happened, and the sphere of protected speech was expanded, fortunately. So by the time we got to the Vietnam War, you could not be arrested for advocating that people dodge the draft or move to Canada or go underground or burn their draft cards. But to stand up in public now and say that speech that is incitement should not be protected is to say that we should go back to what we had during World War I, when we were incarcerated for opposing wars. So no, I cannot be in favor of that. Finally, I've heard it mentioned many times that the university could have stopped the Indianapolis speeches by making the student clubs who had invited him pay the security costs. I've heard this from numerous faculty and from students. Now let's think about that for a minute. The counter the counter situation would be, imagine that there's a pro-choice event on campus and a bunch of really militant, violent, anti-abortion activists show up to protest. Are we going to charge the pro-choice event organizers for the security of their event? If we have a Black Lives Matter event and the KKK shows up, should we charge the event for their security? Ultimately, what you have there is you'd have an obvious perverse incentive that anybody who wanted to stop some speech could just threaten enough violence that the people who were engaging in the speech couldn't afford the cost of the speech. That speech that you buy. So whoever has money gets to speak. How can that be a good thing? So I do not agree. In fact, I strongly oppose. Now, threats. There's a lot of confusion on this. Threats are not protected speech. They never have been. They are not now. So, for example, these threats here to Brianna Wu, one of the poor women who was run out of her home during the whole Gamergate fiasco. This is not protected speech. And we don't have to give up any of our constitutional rights to make this unprotected speech. It's already unprotected speech. Now, legally, the bar on what constitutes a threat is high. The court would want to know that it's an immediate threat, like, am I going to attack you in the next 10 minutes, not in the next 10 years. So it can be a complex thing to show. But and we want the bar to be high. There's good reasons for it to be high, but nobody would claim that these kinds of horrendous things that people are tweeting to Brianna Wu would be protected speech. Now, there's also very vexing problems here in terms of the internet and electronic communications. I mean, Brianna Wu might get hateful messages from 1,000 different Twitter accounts for the next 4 years, and it could turn out to be all one person with 1,000 different Twitter accounts. In fact, it could turn out to be an algorithm. So, I mean, it could be algorithmically generated speech making her life miserable. If an algorithm talks, is that speech? I don't know. What I'm trying to say is that these are vexing issues which are which we need to think deeply about, because they are coloring our time in a very, very ugly way. So yes, we need to address these issues, but no, the first step in addressing them is not to give up the few constitutional rights that we have. The last thing I want to note is that free speech rights have historically protected minorities. That's why we have them, to protect minorities from majorities. Today, student Republicans are a small, hated minority on liberal college campuses. But it was not so long ago in this country that queers were a small, hated minority. And you couldn't even speak about homosexuality, even in a negative way, in printed materials that you sent through the mail. And before the internet, that was the only way queers had to talk to each other. And you could be arrested for talking about homosexuality on paper and sending it through the mail, even if what you were saying was that it was horrible. And it was only in 1958 that the Supreme Court ruled that no, discussion of homosexuality was protected speech. And everything we have in today's LGBT community rests on that Supreme Court decision, which was made at a time when the vast majority of Americans were baffled at why this would be protected speech, why the Supreme Court would think it was okay to talk about sinful and despicable and disgusting sexual practices that were imagined to be committed by sexual predators who were coming for your children. And yet the Supreme Court stood up and said, no, this is protected speech, and we allow it. We are living in a terrible time. The Trump era is a dark, dark time. The dangers are real. There's nothing I've said that should be taken in any way to think that I am minimizing or soft peddling the very real dangers confronting our country and the world right now. And I understand that students are freaked out. They should be. I'm freaked out. If the rest of the faculty isn't freaked out, then I don't know what planet they're on. It's a frightening time. Many students want to go out in the streets and fight fascism. I understand that. The problem is, there's no fascists in the street to fight. The people who would be the brown shirts in the moment are all jerking off to internet porn in their parents' basements. So you go out the streets to fight fascism and you find the campus police. Or some poor hippie with a sign that says, support free speech. The Nazi Party was a paramilitary organization engaged in street brawls before they were even a political party. That is not the political moment we're living in. Let's think about this for a moment. The key issue here is the assault on the institutions of democracy. These are what need to be defended. Slogans like become ungovernable, or no more presidents, like the Black Bloc banner in Seattle said. They're exactly the opposite idea. What we need to do is defend democracy, which means more presidents. I am all in favor of militant struggle. Please, nothing that I've said should be taken in any way to think that I think we just need to be polite and, well-behaved. But let's engage in militant struggle that makes sense. We have immigrants being deported and treated horribly. If you want to do militant struggle, let's go defend immigrants, let's put our bodies on the line, get in the way, not let them be deported. There's mosques and Jewish synagogues and community centers that are being burned down and threatened with bombs. There's all kinds of opportunities where militant struggle makes sense. But shutting down speech on college campuses is not one of them. And the last thing I want to say is that if the Trump moment has taught us anything, it's that the power that's at stake here was won electorally. And we need to take it back electorally. In 2 years, we have to win the by-election 2 years from now. If Trump and Bannon and Jeff Sessions do what they're doing for 2 years and then get just as many votes as they got last time, then we are in even more serious trouble than we are now. The right now controls so many state governments in this country. They are 4 states away from being able to call a constitutional convention. That's where we're at. So yes, if you want to really step up to the plate and make yourself counted at this time in history, the militant thing to do is take a quarter off, take a semester off, take a year off, and go to Missouri or go to flyover country and engage in a process that hopefully will move the meter back in a democratic and tolerant, sane direction 2 years from now. Okay, thank you for watching. I hope you think seriously about this. If you disagree, please let me know. If you agree, please let me know. Most of all, I hope you will join me in the struggle to keep democracy in this country.